Rocketeer.
Rocketeer.
I want that rocket.
What's his name?
I'm a Rocketeer.
I like it.
Many of us take flying for granted. Whether it's a simple flying machine or a sophisticated aircraft, though, there's still a kind of magic in our ability to fly. But one dream of flight has yet to be realized. A person flying virtually on his own without the aid of an airplane. Just imagine strapping a rocket to your back and taking off. Impossible, you say? Well, not if you're the Rocketeer.
There's excitement in the air as the Rocketeer, Bill Campbell, takes you behind the scenes of this summer's high-altitude movie adventure. Then meet real-life Rocketeers who soar in flying devices that mix daring excitement with danger.
This would appear an awful lot like strapping a bomb to your back.
And discover the secret of flying a man without a plane. It's all part of a special sneak peek at The Rocketeer.
Just who is The Rocketeer? Well, the character and the story all began in the imagination of artist Dave Stevens.
It's the story of a guy who is a racing pilot, stunt pilot, and he comes upon this device, this rocket pack, that he has no idea where it came from, who owned it, only that when he puts it on, he can fly without a plane, and it's every flyer's dream to be able to do that. It's fantasy time.
Action!
The pilot Stevens created is Cliff Secord. Cliff is just a regular Joe who doesn't really have any superpowers.
It's the trappings that make him look like something more than human. He's basically every man. He's a pilot extraordinaire, and that helps him in mastering this machine.
The rocket pack is a sophisticated machine, so keeping the Rocketeer airborne is not as simple as filling a tank of gas. It takes a little magic, courtesy of some very special effects.
Is he gonna start the back?
Rehearsing and action.
Director Joe Johnston knows how to surprise us. In his first movie, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, he made us all believe that a kid could be less than an inch tall. Now he's faced with the job of getting the Rocketeer off the ground.
The most important thing about that for me was that you really believe that this thing is pushing this guy through the air.
Once Cliff finds the rocket, he's thrown into a world of danger. Everybody wants the rocket pack. The FBI.
This is the FBI!
Nazi spies. Gangland thugs. Even a Hollywood matinee idol.
I want that rocket, Eddie.
And that rocket's got to be got. And he's got to get it for his side. And his side isn't the good side.
Briefly seduced by Sinclair's dashing charm is Cliff's best girl, Jenny Blake. Her infatuation with Sinclair lands her right in the middle of the chase.
When it all boils down, she's been looking at Neville Sinclair, who is Timothy Dalton's character, thinking, this man is my hero. throughout the course of the film, she realizes that he is a sham, basically, and that Cliff is the real hero.
And the hero comes in an aerodynamic package.
When you see him burning through the clouds, I mean, it looks like a rocket. You know, it looks like a human missile.
For Cliff Secord, the ultimate dream of flight is realized when his afterburners ignite.
It's been a common dream of all men everywhere to try to fly like a bird.
The dream begins in ancient mythology. Icarus tempted fate by flying too close to the sun and plunged to his death. Leonardo da Vinci's 15th century concepts were the work of a visionary. However, the practicality of his bird-like harness was never tested. Other creative thinkers have followed.
The laws by which these wings are manipulated are the old lost laws of Greek cosmic motion, which I have rediscovered.
Dreamers through the ages have had mixed results, but undaunted, continued to develop a variety of flying contraptions. Most met with limited success.
And it's my strong conviction that by utilizing these inner universal forces, we shall all be able to fly like the birds.
I wouldn't touch that if I were you.
Even when the design succeeds, there's always a learning process before a daring pilot gets it right.
They set it off the first time completely by accident. It bounces around the inside of the hangar and trashes the trashes their hangar. And then they strap it to a statue of Charles Lindbergh that they steal from the flight school.
Turn around!
He doesn't just, you know, find the thing, strap it on, and fly away.
I think we're gonna need a helmet.
How do I look?
Like a hood ornament.
I'm getting it. I don't know what it is, but I'm getting it.
Why don't you just call him Rocket Boy?
Nah, that's lousy. What about the
Rocket Man?
That's worse.
What about Missile Man?
Nah, that stinks. Come on, Bigelow, give us a better name.
How about Rocketeer?
Rocketeer?
That's swell.
It is often said that the best way to understand a person is to take a look at what that individual has left behind. This impressive monument to the life of one man is the largest airplane ever built, the Spruce Goose. And it sits here in its immense home in Long Beach, California. Its creator was Howard Hughes, a genius whose aircraft design and experimentation changed the course of aviation history. To Cliff Secord, the Rocketeer, Howard Hughes played a very important role as well. He was, quite simply, the father of the Rocket Pack.
Howard Hughes, man of action.
Drop the ladder!
I designed the Cirrus X3.
What was it like, strapping that thing to your back?
It was the closest I'll ever get to heaven, Mr. Hughes.
Where's my rocket pack, Secord?
Nothing to it, Howard, just basic aviation.
Heroic flyer, adventurer, and designer, Howard Hughes was at the forefront of the aviation world in his day, and the aircraft he built anticipated the future.
We had several of the space shuttle astronauts down here touring the Spruce Goose, and they pointed out things that are still used in the space shuttle and on large aircraft today.
The Spruce Goose was built nearly 50 years ago. And flown only once. Yet it is still the largest winged object ever to have left the Earth's surface. Just how possible would it have been for a daring innovator like Howard Hughes, or any of his contemporaries for that matter, to have conceived of and built the ultimate flying device, a rocket-powered backpack? the fastest planes and broke all of the aviation speed records of his day. And even though a lot is known about Hughes, there are still quite a few mysteries.
There are quite a few things that Hughes aircraft developed that people don't know about. Hughes was incredibly ahead of his time. He always tried to be on the forefront and to use the latest in technology.
If such a rocket pack actually existed, it would be the type of machine people might die trying to possess, and would certainly end up pitting nations against one another, as the Rocketeer finds out.
The German experiment didn't seem like much to worry about, but when we got our hands on this next film, we realized the scope of their plan. Keep watching, kid. It cost a man's life to get this out of Germany.
It's the ultimate showdown for the Rocketeer when he's forced to protect more than just the rocket pack against Nazi invaders.
When he flies the first time, he makes a lot of mistakes.
Big gopher.
There's definitely a learning process going on in there.
Flying on one's own. Well, the experience ranges from machines like this gyroplane, no wings involved, to the purest and simplest form of flight, hang gliding. With a wing and a little wind, you can soar like a bird.
I feel fine.
One hitch, the first step could be a 500-foot drop.
Okay, goodbye.
Ooh, oh my God.
Okay. Holy cow.
A tandem flight is recommended for pilots in training. Gliding like this realizes a dream of flight that's existed since the beginning of time.
My folks are never, ever gonna believe that I did this.
With the gyroplane, it's one flyer, one engine, and a step closer to soaring like the Rocketeer.
Ken, what is a gyroplane?
There's two rotorcraft ratings in this country, and one is a helicopter and the other is a gyroplane. And both of them have rotor blades, but that's where the similarity ends. It flies more like a fixed-wing aircraft. See, a high-wing airplane you can't see up, and a low-wing airplane you can't see down, but this you can see you're like in a sphere.
Almost as if you were flying without a plane.
That's correct.
You have to be a trained pilot to step into this flying chair that travels close to 100 miles per hour. With tons of fresh air blasting against the pilot and a 360-degree view, it's easy to see why they call it a flying freedom machine. No pilot's license required here. This may be the closest step towards a machine designed for just about anyone to fly. These are the paraplanes of coastal flight in Santa Ynez, California.
Just imagine yourself. It's like a flying dream. You just sit down, push the throttle forward, and away you go. The more you think, the more time you have to get yourself into trouble. So we bring you down quick, and we bring you down hard. So don't worry about how easily or how hard you land. It's gonna be a tough landing anyway. Okay.
Basically, I'm in a shopping cart with an engine and a bed sheet. I guess this proves anyone can fly.
None of the stunts in the Rocketeer could have prepared me for this. There are no special effects here. And as goofy as the paraplane looks and feels, you can still go up to a frightening 10,000 feet.
Congratulations, you're now a paraplane pilot.
You too can fly.
This is it, the dream and the reality. Individual rocket-powered flight. The guy who flies this thing can't take it for granted. If the rocket fails up there at 200 feet, well, you just can't flap your arms and hope for the best. This rocket pack is the result of years of study, research, and testing. There have been a lot of rocket packs in the last 60 years. Most didn't work. But slowly, Rocketeers got the formula right. And then a variety of rocket packs took shape. There really are guys like Cliff Secord who put themselves at incredible risk each time they take off. To give you an idea of the danger, a trained medical team is on standby whenever rocket man Kenny Gibson takes flight. So, Kenny, to the untrained eye, this would appear an awful lot like strapping a bomb to your back.
It is a rocket. You know, there's been a lot of attempts at people flying with rockets on their backs. If we did lose our motor, it's a rock.
So you fall.
Yep.
Kenny, that was great. That was amazing.
Kind of reminds you of yours?
Yeah, somewhat, I guess.
Tell you what, we got a little extra fuel over there. We'll fuel it up, and you can take it for a test spin.
No, I don't think so. No, not till the sequel.
A rocket?
Yeah. Like in the comic books.
Where's what?
The rocket.
Open up, FBI.
Look.
Go get him, kid.
Technology and creative thinking got Rocketeer Kenny Gibson off the ground. And it took a fair degree of skill and imagination to get this Rocketeer in the air as well. The Rocketeer took to the air with help from a virtual army of movie makers. A variety of methods were used to create the spectacular flying sequences. Stuntmen were suspended from helicopter mounts. And occasionally, they were dropped from planes. But many of the flying effects were created with the assistance of some very special movie-making wizardry at Industrial Light and Magic. ILM is renowned for having created extraordinary effects for movies that have ranged from Star Wars to the wacky Roger Rabbit.
How can I ever repay you?
Ah! Rocketeer director Joe Johnston was an Academy Award-winning effects supervisor for ILM before directing his first feature, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
They used just about every technique in the special effect handbook, which they wrote. They're using everything from miniature puppets to full-scale doubles in front of a blue screen to animation, for flame enhancement. The great thing about that is that they're combining all those techniques into each sequence.
For everything to work, art, technology, and ingenuity had to blend to create the illusion of a man flying at awesome speeds. A tough job for effects supervisor Ken Ralston and his staff.
Probably the biggest challenge, again, is the flying, to make that believable and to also not have it stand out as a whole separate part of the movie. And luckily, we've been able to just stay ahead with the technology of the wishes of the director. We have animator skills that are so high that we can use a puppet most of the time because you won't know it's a puppet. It'll look just like a real man flying around.
We're at a point now where individual flight without a plane becomes more of a reality every day. A day may come when it's a common sight to see a person flying around like a rocket-powered bird. But that day's not here yet, unless you're the Rocketeer. And with the push of a button, boom, I'm out of here.